Good morning, CFM, and thank you for being with us today. We are blessed to have each and every one of you join with us every Sunday. For this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Family, we have made great strides in this pandemic, but there are COVID variants that are fast becoming dangerous, and the vaccine rate among communities of color is still low. There are various reasons for our communities not wanting to get vaccinated, and there may be people watching who have their own reasons, but we would like to encourage you all to get the vaccine, and we will be having a non-traditional worship service soon to talk about this very topic. Now, wherever you are, we ask that you join us in praising His name. We serve a magnificent God. He is our provider, our protector, our father, and our mother. He is due all the praise and every word of worship. His love surrounds us, and aren't we glad? Everywhere that we look, His love is all around. All around, all around. Everywhere I look, your love is all around. You say, all around, all around. Everywhere I look, your love is all around. All around, all around. Everywhere I look, your love is all around. All around, all around. Everywhere I look, your love is all around. All around, all around. Everywhere I look, your love is all around. Let the nation sing, let the people shout. Oh, oh, oh. Let your kingdom come, pour your spirit out. Manifest, manifest, manifest your love. Manifest, manifest your love. Love. All around, all around. Everywhere I look, your love is all around. All around, all around. Everywhere I look, your love is all around. Let the nation sing, let the people shout. Oh, oh, oh. Let your kingdom come, pour your spirit out. Your love is too deep to navigate, and it's too high to climb,
too high to climb,
but it's still available time after time, after time, after time,
after time,
after time. Your love lifted me.
Oh yes,
your love is too deep to navigate. And it's too high to climb,
so high,
but it's still available. Time after time,
after time,
after time, after time, after time. Can I get a witness? Everywhere I look, your love is all around. Everywhere I look, your love is all around.
Everywhere I look, your love is all around.
Everywhere I look, your love is all around.
Everywhere I look, your love is all around.
Everywhere I look, your love is all around.
All around.
All around.
Everywhere I look, your love is all around.
All around.
All around.
Everywhere I look, your love is all around.
All around.
All around.
Everywhere I look, your love is all around.
All around.
All around.
Everywhere I look, your love is all around.
All around.
All around.
Everywhere I look, your love is all around.
All around.
All around.
Everywhere I look, your love is 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 all around.
Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before God's presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, she is God. It is God that has made us and not we ourselves. We are God's people and the sheep of God's pasture. So enter into his gates with thanksgiving and enter into God's courts with praise. Be thankful unto God and bless God's holy name. For the Lord is good. God's mercy endures forever, and his truth endures to all generations. Praise ye the Lord.
And now we praise God with our hands and voices, and we pray that further our Lord taught us to pray. When his disciples asked him, Lord, how do you pray? And he answered, you pray like this.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
I'll be reading from Isaiah chapter 30, verses 19 through 22, and John chapter 10, verses 1 through 6 from the New International Version. Isaiah 30, verse 19. People of Zion, who live in Jerusalem, you will weep no more. How gracious he will be when you cry for help. As soon as he hears, he will answer you. Although the Lord gives you the bread of adversity and the water of affliction, your teachers will be hidden no more. With your own eyes, you will see them. Whether you turn to the right or to the left, your ears will hear a voice behind you saying, "This is the way. Walk in it." Then you will desecrate your idols overlaid with silver and your images covered with gold. You will throw them away like a minstrel cloth and say to them, "Away with you." John chapter 10, verses 1 through 6. Verse 1. Very truly I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Let the Lord add a blessing to the reading, the hearing, and the understanding of his holy word.
And I ask you now to pray with me as we invite God into this worship service. Spirit of the living God, come now and rest with us in this service. We know that if you're not here, we don't have a service. We know that if your presence isn't surrounding us, if you are not in front of us and in back of us and on either side of us, we have no worship service. We are glad that it doesn't matter to you if a service is virtual or in person. We know that what you look for is our hearts. And so God, we give you our hearts in this worship service. We ask you to move anything out of our hearts that might get in the way of us being completely available to you and being available to have you access our own spirits. We come to worship you, Lord God. We come, and so make this time your time through what we do and through what we say. In the name of Jesus, amen. Everyone, it's so good to see you this morning. I hope that you're having a really good weekend. Before I start the sermon, I just want to put a pitch in for people to get vaccinated. This virus, COVID-19, has not gone away. They have variants, and if you don't get vaccinated, the chances of you getting this disease are very great. The reports say that if you have gotten vaccinated, if you are fully vaccinated, you might get the disease, but it won't throw you down. But the reports also say that those who are not vaccinated are getting this variant form of COVID-19, and it's really making them really sick. People get sick for the time that they're sick, but they also have these periods of time where they are having side effects, and some people are having effects long, long, long after the actual disease has gone. COVID-19 is affecting Black people way too much more frequently than it is affecting other people, and we can't afford it. We are fighting COVID-19 even while we are still fighting HIV/AIDS. So I'm hoping that you will decide to take the plunge, to trust God, and to go and get your vaccination and take your family members, those who can, check with your doctor if you have medical conditions that might make you susceptible to some sort of complication. But if you don't have any of that, trust the doctors, trust science, bigger than that, trust God, and know that it will be okay. We have already lost way too many people. We don't need to lose any more. So I hope that you will take a moment and get the vaccine. Thanks. That being said, pray with me for a few minutes on the subject, when we refuse to hear. When we refuse to hear. You know, I'll bet most of us can remember putting our hands over our ears when we were little, because, you know, we didn't want to hear what somebody was saying to us. I can remember there was a girl named Wanda Harper. I just did not like her. We were so-called best friends, but I didn't like her. And she was always picking on me. And then she would say things, and she would say mean things. And so when she would come and kind of get in my face, I would cover my ears. I didn't want to hear what she had to say. we could do that. I would put my hands over my ears, or sometimes she would talk and I'd talk over, making all kinds of noises. I actually saw the former president doing stuff like that, which is amazing to me. But the fact of the matter is that there are things that we just do not want to hear. We can't really say that we listen to anyone until we hear someone. Hearing is defined as the process and functional power of perceiving sound. We have to perceive the sound that's coming from some and see that the sound includes words. The dictionary says that that is the definition of hearing. Listening, it says, on the other hand, means to pay attention to sound, to hear something with thoughtful consideration and give it all the attention that we can. So it's clear by definition that one has to be willing to hear first the sound of another's voice and the words that those sounds are carrying in order to get to a place where what that person is saying resonates with us or stimulates or encourages us to consider what's being said. All too often, we do not hear, we do not want to hear words from anybody, including God, that we think are going to be detrimental or negative or somehow not the flowery words and affirmations and praise that we all want and need. We would rather stay where we are and continue on as we have always worked and lived if it means that to change, we have to hear some negative stuff about ourselves. So I got to thinking about that this week. When I heard a colleague say that we walk with deliberate deafness, and that just floored me. I think it's crazy that we take the gift of hearing for granted. People who cannot hear yearn to hear sounds, but we who can hear too often choose to deliberately shut out the sound of the voices of people whose words bother us because they challenge us or criticize us or remind us of things that we don't want to think about. I saw a video that included the resistance that some woman who was addicted carried with her. This person, she was addicted to opioids, and she was being advised by a doctor of what she needed to do in order to make sure that her entire body did not shut down, which it was doing because her addiction had led to serious medical problems. But she refused to let the sound of the doctor's voice penetrate her consciousness. She interrupted him. She talked over him. She turned away from him. She attacked him. She did everything she could to discourage him and make him stop talking to her own detriment. And after some few minutes, she won. The doctor stopped talking. I don't know what happened to her, but my thought is that she probably is not even alive now because she would not listen. She did not want to hear what he was saying. She did not want to hear that her opioid addiction was killing her. She would rather have stayed on opioids and make this exclamation, well, he can't tell me what to do and he's trying to control me. No, he was trying to save your life, but she didn't want to hear it. And my thought is that she's probably not even alive anymore. But to be sure, there are things we don't want to hear. Bad things are disturbing to hear. Scary things are disturbing to hear. We don't want to hear that we've gained weight. I can remember getting angry when people say, remember when you gained a couple of pounds? We don't want to hear that. We don't want to hear that. We don't want to hear that maybe we are drinking too much or maybe we do have a drug problem. We will get angry and shut off the sound of the voices of those who put those realities in our faces. Haven't you seen programs on television, the interventions that are held, and the people who love the one who is addicted just want them to stop and to hear what people are saying. And they're saying what they're saying because of what they are seeing. But people in those interventions too often just storm out. They don't want to hear it. We don't want to hear that we have a terminal illness or an illness period. I know some people who should have been to the doctor 3-4 years ago, but they will not go. The longer you stay away from hearing the truth about your health, the more sick you get. And I have a couple of friends, I worry about them all the time. I ask them if they've gone to the doctor. They say, no, I don't need it. I'm okay. But I can see that they're not okay. But I understand we don't want to hear that something's wrong. We don't want to hear that we might have heart failure or diabetes or cancer, or we don't want to hear that we may have something wrong with our thyroid or our liver is not functioning well. We don't want to hear it. We want everything to be okay, even when we know everything is not okay. We don't want to hear it. We don't want to hear that our children, whom we think are the little darlings of the world, are really not so darling when they're in school. We don't want to hear that they are causing trouble. We don't want to hear that they're disrupting the class. We don't want to hear that they are not doing their homework. We don't want to hear any of that. And some of us as parents will go to the school and shut the teachers down and shut them out. We don't want to hear it. We want them to tell us that our little darlings are perfect little babies and you're brilliant and all that. But when they're not brilliant, sometimes people have to tell us that. We don't want to hear it. When it comes to relationships, we don't want to hear that the person that we are in love with has some issues. You know, sometimes your friends are the best sources of truth that you have. And they can see what you cannot see when you are in love, because you can't see anything when you are in love. But we don't want our friends to say, something's wrong. I don't know. There's something about this guy or something about this woman. I'm just not thinking that you two are going to get together. We don't want to hear it. We get angry. Sometimes I have heard people say, you're just saying that because you're jealous. No, I'm not jealous. Not of that. But I love you enough to want to tell you what I see. We don't want to hear it. We don't want to hear that someone that we love is not going to recover from an illness. In spite of what we're told, we keep pushing and pushing for more treatments that the doctors say are just not going to work. We don't want to hear that we did not do so well making a presentation. We don't want to hear that we're not so good of a preacher, that the sermons that we give are just not so good. We don't want to hear that a person that we thought was a friend is really competing for the job that we have. We don't want to hear any of that. And I go back a second to relationships, because we live in a world where relationships are important. It is important to have relationships, but for some of us, it like defines who we are. And some people feel like if they're not in a relationship, they're not whole. So sometimes we stay in relationships that we really know are gone. They're over, but we don't want to hear it. We don't want to hear it. I remember the song by Nancy Wilson, Face It, where she breaks down what a doomed relationship looks like and thus feels like. Hers are not words that we want to hear, but she's talking to herself. That's what happens when you finally hear something. You can talk to yourself. And she says, when you look into his eyes and he turns away, sitting at a corner table and there's nothing much to say. Does he have to draw you pictures? Does he have to spell it out? Face it, girl. Ooh, just saying that. Face it, girl. It's over. It is over. What we're going through in this country politically is largely because the former president has refused to hear the words, you lost. I remember when the former president won and the Republicans kept saying about the Democrats, you're just mad because you lost. Well, bye. By golly, isn't it the same thing? These Republicans are just super mad that they lost, and they will not admit it. At least the Democrats admitted it. They didn't like it, but they admitted it. But these people will not admit it. And so this former president has pushed the big lie. And so many people are believing him. It's really scary. And they refuse to hear anything that is the truth, beginning with the words, your guy lost. He just lost. They refuse. They refuse to accept the words, you are traitors, or you betrayed the country. They won't hear it. They're making the insurrection a tourist event. It's just astounding to me. Many people, even as they support racism or sexism or any of the other systems of oppression, will not admit that they are bigots. And these people who are fighting against the truth that the former president won are really fighting along racial lines, but they won't admit that. Did you get the irony of all of the Senate Republicans? This is still astounding to me that all of the Senate Republicans approved Juneteenth as a national holiday, even as they have refused to support the For the People Act. They don't want us to vote, but they give us a holiday because we were released from slavery. It doesn't make any sense. It's not consistent because they don't want to hear it. They can't hear. When you can't hear the truth, you can't say the truth. And they can't say it. I had to shake my head because it makes no sense unless we consider that the behavior we see is the result of not being willing to hear or grow or learn. They don't want to grow. That's why we don't want to hear, because we don't want to grow. We don't want to change. We like being miserable. I've said that before. They don't want to hear the truth. They don't want to hear that what they're doing is racist. And they don't even want to hear that they're not being or following the law. They always like to say that this is a country where we follow the rule of law, but they are going against the law. I think what they're doing is illegal in plain sight, trying to steal and rig all future elections on state and local levels from and federal levels from people that they don't want. They are rigging the election. And if you were to say that, they would not hear it. But they know it's the truth. That's the thing. The things that we don't want to hear, we know are the truth. We know there's some truth in there. We just don't want to deal with it. These Republicans refuse to admit that much of the voter fraud that has been discovered recently has been committed by Republicans. That is, if the reports that we read are true. There's a story this week about a man, a white guy, who registered his dead mama and then cast a vote in her name. When he was tracked as having done that, he actually wrote a letter to the election board, the board of election where he lived, and he swore that she was still alive. When the state was able to produce her death certificate, he said, oh, shoot, I guess I got caught. Okay, so he got caught, he got arrested, and he was given 5 years probation by the judge. And when I read that, I just said, do you not understand why we say Black lives don't matter? We say Black lives matter because Black lives don't matter. Because I thought of Crystal Mason, a Black woman who had been released from prison. And she, when she got out, she wanted to vote. So she went to her precinct and she asked if she could vote. She was recently released from prison. The poll worker said that she could cast a provisional ballot. And so she did. She asked permission. She asked if it was okay. The poll judge told her that it was. A week or so later, she was arrested for voter fraud and she was sentenced to 5 years in prison. No probation like this other guy, this white guy, 5 years in prison. We have reasons for protesting and saying that Black lives matter because we need for Black lives to matter. But the people who are in charge, the people in power, don't want to hear that. That truth is too bitter for them. And that's what we don't want. We don't want the bitter truth. These people, many people, Democrats, Republicans, it doesn't matter. Many people are arguing about critical race theory. They don't even know what it is. But they don't want to sit in the class and talk about it. When General Milley this week said to Matt Gaetz, who I don't think should even be, you know, on anybody's committee, but who am I? But when he said, I don't understand what the problem is. He says, I read Lenin and I read Stalin and I've read, you know, different authors. Yeah, it doesn't mean that I'm communist. He said, I want to understand what white rage is about. And oh my goodness, the conservative media is jumping all over him saying that he is hating white people. Duh. That's what happens when you don't want to hear the truth. You take what you think you hear, which because you really don't hear, and you mix it up in some weird conglomeration, some combination, and come out with what you want to come out with because you are still trying to stay where you are. You still want to hold on to what you have always believed. I was chuckling when I thought about how we as people live in myth. You know, America is filled with myths. And so the biggest myth is, and I thought about this because of Juneteenth, that Abraham Lincoln freed the slaves. He didn't. He wrote the Emancipation Proclamation to free enslaved people who lived in the states that were fighting against the Union, but he didn't even free all of the enslaved people in all of the slave states. The border states, the people who were enslaved in those states had to remain enslaved. And so he died in April of 1865, and then in June of 1865, General Granger comes to Galveston and he issues General Order Number 3. And that's the document that says all slaves are free, because people in Texas, and they knew that the Emancipation Proclamation had been issued, but people who were enslaving them wanted to hold on to them. And so they continued to hold on to them. And so the myth was that they didn't know. And so when Juneteenth came, it's because they finally got the news that they had been freed. It's just cockamamie. It's crazy to believe that for 2 years, these people would not have known that they were freed. But anyway, they were not released by their owners. And so when General Order Number 3 was given and said all slaves are free, then really that freed all of the enslaved people in the country, not the Emancipation Proclamation. But if we were to say that in a group of people who say that they are American, there'd probably be a war. Many lawmakers and others who do not work in government but who support policies that keep Black people under thumb will not hear that they're racist. They will not hear that they are sexist. They will not hear that they are bigoted in any shape, way, or form. They will tell you that something is wrong with you. They refuse to admit it. What you cannot admit, you cannot fix. If you cannot admit that you have an illness, no medicine can be prescribed for you to make you better. If you cannot hear that you are sexist, you will continue to do sexist things. I am appalled at a level of sexism in this country. Lawmakers are unconcerned that many of the people who suffered most during the pandemic are women, single moms, moms with 2-3 children, the women who worked in service jobs or in corporations that refused to let them stay home, that threatened to fire them if they stayed home, if they felt sick. These women stayed on the job, many of them in positions where they make so little money. These are especially waitresses. They make so little money that they can't even file income taxes. It is too poor. They worked when they were sick. They worked for horrible wages. They don't make a living wage. And these people who pass these policies will not admit that they are economically exploiting women, especially, but the poor in general. These people prefer to spout and share the convenient and longstanding untruth that people are poor because they are lazy. They do not want to hear, and they will not admit that people are poor because corporations refuse to pay them a fair and working wage. In my opinion, the plantation system never left this country. As we use slave labor or as slave labor was used to build this country, this economy, slave labor really is still in effect now. If you don't get paid what you're worth, that to me is that type of exploitation is enslaving people, keeping people beholden to you for these teeny tiny wages that won't let them live a decent life. There's one thing that people will admit. That they are homophobic. They will say that, you know, they're homophobic because God didn't make men to sleep with men or women to sleep with women. So they will admit that they're homophobic. But some people who are homophobic won't even admit that. They'll put it all on God. No, that's not on God. That's on you. They want to. Okay, so I kind of don't believe in this, but it's not because of me. It's because the Bible said. It's the same type of thing that people would do to justify their racism and their sexism. They just use the Bible, but they won't admit that they're racist or sexist. They will admit that they're homophobic, which is an important thing to realize as we celebrate Pride and lift up our brothers and sisters in the LGBTQIA community. So not hearing or being willing to hear keeps one self-oppressed. There can be no growth, no healing, no joy, no comfort, no revelation, no true observations, no communication, no true communication, until one is willing to hear the truth. One is willing to hear what they don't want to hear. If I don't think I've gained weight, then I'm not going to try to lose weight. If I finally hear that I've lost weight, and I finally then look at myself in a different way, I will begin to make some changes. That's just the way truth works. When you hear it, you respond to it, you can begin to see things differently, and then you can begin to listen and therefore put yourself on a path to change and to grow. Once people hear, they can consider being a new person in Christ. Behold, all things are past, old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. If you are willing to hear and then to listen and then to act. Why don't we want to hear bad things? Because we're afraid. Truth scares us. What actually is, as opposed to what we wish things would be, is too painful for us to bear. We prefer myths. We prefer to live in make-believe worlds than in the world that needs truth to be seen and known. Truth hurts because truth is honest. So if we refuse to hear the truth, we don't have to deal with the repercussions of the truth. Even when we are miserable in our present situations, the prospect of thinking differently or living differently or believing differently is a scary thought to us. We prefer familiar misery to unfamiliar possibility. Fear keeps us locked up and locked out of our full potential for life. This country is like a canoe trying to float on a body of water, but it's unable because the canoe has so many holes in it. Some holes in our souls, are visible. Our souls are like boats, and some holes in our souls are visible, but some are not. Just like in a canoe, the holes are caused by the rotting of what the canoe is made of. Our souls get holes because our souls are rotted by the things that we go through in life, and we refuse. And the more we refuse, the more that poison, the poison of dishonesty, the poison of deception gets into our souls, and it begins to erode us bit by bit. We have holes in our souls. And those holes, untreated, unattended, ignored, threaten to cause us to sink in our own dishonesty, our own lack of awareness. We can sink in our own stuff. That's why I say it's self-oppression. We can finally decide to listen to the truth, but sometimes it's too late. Just like if you're in a canoe and you decide, oh, really, we really do have holes. If you wait too long, the boat's going to sink. And if we don't act forthwith and understand that we don't have a whole lot of time to just sit around and wait, we can cause our own souls to drown in our own misery. We as a country and as individuals walking around, we are walking around with deliberate deafness, deliberate deafness. We are choosing to violate and ignore one of the gifts that God gave us to make us whole, because without hearing and then listening, no nation or individual can experience the fullness of grace. That means getting to a state where we see ourselves as God sees us. And I'm telling you, when you get to that state, you just don't want to look at it. When you get to that place where you really look at yourself, you understand the song Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me, and bigger than that, you wonder how God can even deal with us. You deal with who we are. It is a gift. We recognize grace at that point as being a gift, a free gift that we did not earn. But we cannot grow if we will not hear the truth. Just can't do it. There are so many of us walking around with stunted spiritual growth. Some of us know it, but many of us do not. Our being unwilling to hear has made us incapable of personal discernment, leading us to understand that we need to be in another space, a space provided for us by God here on this earth. God is always preparing the way for us because God can see what we do not see. Because we will not see it. This is my first point, that we should not refuse to hear the truth because our authentic relationship with God has prepared us to handle it. We are prepared for the truth. God has prepared us for the truth. Remember, God doesn't make any mistakes. God, the perfection of God, part of the perfection of God cause in God knowing or falls comes because of God knowing who we are and how we respond and how much we can take. The Lord won't put much more on you than you can bear. We can say that is a truth, and we know it because we have lived it. God has prepared us to accept and be able to bear the truth. He has prepared us. God knows how hearing the truth will rock us, but God has already altered the path of the journey to make handling the truth we hear a little easier to bear. The evangelist John says in the gospel, says that anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. Jesus then is our shepherd, and Jesus has prepared us. Jesus is shepherding us. And because Jesus is our shepherd, we should trust him. God, through his son Jesus, has given us more strength than we know we even have, which equips us then to handle the truth and to use it for our growth. God is not a parent who desires us to fail and to fall. No, God wants us to walk in the fullness of grace, which we cannot do if we are walking in lies, which make us comfortable but incapable of having an authentic life. The blessed assurance in our walk is that Jesus knows us all by name and does not condemn us or judge us for who we are or where we have been or what we have done. That is blessed assurance. We are part of the family. When one of us is lost, we are all invested in finding that person, and Jesus, as the shepherd, will find us and lead us and guide us and comfort us as we deal with the truths that we now see face to face. Jesus knows the ones who right now are running from God, running from their family, running, as is the case with the Republicans, from truth, running from racism, running. And Jesus is looking for them, because we all matter. And Jesus is looking for you too. No, you don't want to be found. True believers will know the sound of Jesus' voice. We will know the sound of his voice. And if we have unplugged our ears, we can hear it. If we keep our ears plugged, we can miss the sound of Jesus' voice, which is a bad thing to do when Jesus really is our way and our truth and our light. Those who are running will hear other sounds, and they maybe will open their ears for those, but the sound that they need to hear, that we need to hear and abide by, is the sound of the one who loves them. I compare this to the way God disciplines us. We don't like to feel like or believe that God chastises us or punishes us, but God does, according to the Bible. And the way I have explained it in my Bible classes is that there is a difference between God punishes us and the world punishes us. It's the same thing that my mother would say that I thought about later on in life, that our parents chastising us and giving us a spanking is different from what the world would do. The world does not care about us. So our mothers and our fathers spanking us is done with love. God chastising us is done with love for the intention of making us face the truth and make some different decisions so that we can be in alignment with the ways that we need to be in order to have our most full life. Those who are running from the sound of the words they don't want to hear will take the wrong path. But if you stop long enough to trust God, you will hear the voice of Jesus and know that this voice is from one who loves you, who wants the best for you. Because no matter what mess you are in, no matter how bad things are, things will get better when us decide to stop running and to hear God's voice. In the book of Isaiah, God is concerned because God's people will not hear his voice. All through the Hebrew scriptures, they just don't want to hear God's voice. The Israelites are insisting on going their own way and doing their own thing at their own expense, to their own detriment. God calls to them, Yahweh calls to them repetitively, asking them to return to him. And here is what he says in the book of Isaiah. Truly, O people in Zion, inhabitants of Jerusalem, you shall weep no more. He will surely be gracious to you at the sound of your cry. The prophet is trying to tell the people that you don't have to worry. You are miserable. If you cry out, God will hear you. Which leads me to my second point. We should not refuse to hear God, because in our misery, God hears our cry. If you don't cry, God can't hear you. God can't hear you. God needs to hear us. God had to hear Moses. God had to hear the cry of Hagar when she was in the wilderness. God has to hear us. God hears the sound of our cries. God hears the moans, the weeping that we need to do. When we cry, God hears, and we all cry. We all cry when our refusal to hear God results in us experiencing spiritual and emotional pain. God always hears our cries. Bank on that. God always hears our cries. The prophet Isaiah goes on, though the Lord may give you the bread of adversity and the water of affliction, yet your teacher will not hide himself anymore, but your eyes shall see your teacher. The writer is making an observation that sooner or later we will turn to God. Sometimes we cry and stay separated from God. We cry and still ignore and avoid God. Now, God has heard us, but we are still ignoring God. We have cried. As soon as we cry, God hears us, but we still continue to avoid God. But this prophet is suggesting that after a while, our crying almost forces us to turn to the source of all healing, which is God. God may give us the bread of adversity and the water of affliction to try to bring us to him, to let us know that he hears our cries, so he can let us know that he has seen our misery and our pain and our situation. Sometimes God will give us the bread of affliction and the water of the bread of adversity and the water of affliction, so we will turn to God And however you want to deal with that theologically, you have to do it. But sometimes that happens. But he doesn't do it, though, to hurt us, but to inspire us or to encourage us to turn toward God and to run toward God, no matter the pain or the cost. When God hears our cry, because we cry out, the trajectory toward deliverance is set. Once we see God, something happens. And this is my third point. Once we see God, we begin to hear God. It is as though seeing God causes a spiritual chain reaction. We see and then we hear, which leads me to my third point. If we look for God, we will find God. God will be found. Seek ye the Lord while he may yet be found. When we are looking for God, we will find God. We can't do that. I mean, we cannot and will not look for God when we are in a place of not being willing to deal with the truth, when we're crying but running from God. But when the lies and the myths in which we live start to break us down, ruining and destroying the spiritual fluid between our spiritual joints, causing those joints to rub together like arthritic limbs, causing us pain, we will look toward God. And says Isaiah, quote, when you turn to the right or when you turn to the left, your ears shall hear a word behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. Just saying those words gives me goosebumps. God, who knows where you are, who knows why you are where you are. God, who has seen you running, who has heard you crying, who has given you the bread of misery and the water of affliction. This God says, turn to me. And when you turn, you finally hear him say, this is the way. Walk in it. You will hear the truth spoken by God. And I'm going to tell you that truth will set you free. The Holy Spirit of God will lubricate your spiritual joints left dry from living a life far from God. And your spiritual and emotional pain will be mitigated. You will be free. And you will make the decision to stop walking in deliberate deafness. You will celebrate your journey because you will not be challenged by your past or feel judged by it or ashamed of it. You will feel free. You will be able to say, in spite of all of the things you have carried for so long, it is well. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well because I have finally turned to God. It is well because I know God hears my cry. It is well because God is making a way for me through this wilderness. It is well because I no longer care about what people say to me or about me. It is well because God has inspired me to look inside of myself and see not only my weaknesses, but my strengths. It is well because I have stopped believing that I am nothing, but I see the gifts that God gave me, which I have not been using my whole life. It is well because I can breathe again. It is well. I imagine that our ancestors had moments like that when they said, it is well, it is well. And when you can say it is well, you are giving yourself strength. You leave that realm of self-oppression and you walk in self-liberation, and you walk toward the freedom. You walk toward the freedom that you have always wanted, and you walk toward your newness of life. Don't be afraid to hear the truth. Don't be afraid. It'll knock you around for a bit. It'll cause you some consternation. But don't be afraid. As long as we have God to help us deal with the truth that we must hear in order to be whole, it will be okay. We will say and we will mean, it is well with my soul. Let's listen. Testimony. You have taught me to say, it is well. I've heard the truth, and it is well with my soul. Gift we get for being willing to hear the truth. We can say it is well. So I hope that as you go through this week, you will think about the things that you need to hear that you have been refusing to hear and just submit. Submit to the pulling of your soul and be willing to hear it and let God help you through it. God will not forsake you or judge you or leave you. And that's why we can say it is well with my soul. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you. Oh. thank you. We thank you that the truth does not kill us. We thank you that being willing to hear the truth is the first step toward being delivered and free and being able to say, it is well with my soul. We thank you, Lord, that by us being willing to hear that we get new eyes and we feel a new bubbling in our spirit and we begin to live and to thrive as opposed to just surviving. We are willing to get up and try things and make mistakes and get up all over again. God, in your mercy, hear our genuine thank you. We thank you for being God all by yourself. We thank you for loving us, not because of who we are, but in spite of who we are. We thank you that you have a space for us no matter what, that you welcome us no matter what, that you push us to be who you know the Father and the Mother in heaven have made us to be. God, in your mercy, hear our thanksgiving. We love you. We adore you. We respect you. We reach for you. We yearn for you. And as we struggle to learn how to hear, we will turn toward you so that we can be freed. I ask you to hear this prayer in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you and keep you. God, make God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. God, lift up the countenance of his peace and give you peace in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, who desires that we have ears that will hear. Amen. God bless. Take good care.
Thank you for worshiping here with us today, Crazy Faith. We sincerely hope that something in sermon or song gave you food for thought or ministered to you in some way. Let us know if there are prayer requests so we can pray for you this week. Our mission here at CFM is providing direct service to marginalized communities and doing justice work in a constant fight against injustice. We are collecting socks for the homeless, and our goal for this year is 2,400 pairs of socks. We currently have over 1,000 pairs, so it's steadily going up, and that's a good thing, but let's keep going to get to our goal. You can help us by giving us a donation by going to our sock web store. The link is in the description box, or you can email us to send us a donation of socks directly. Thank you in advance for any help. Join us tomorrow, Monday, June 28th, for a Zoom Bible study at 6:30 p.m. Last week, we dove deeper into the meaning of the prophets and why their work is so difficult. We examine modern day prophets and their importance. Come learn with us and feel free to bring a friend. If you want to help us in our outreach efforts, you can donate through our website or through Venmo or through Cash App. Our Venmo is at crazy-faith. Our Cash App is Red Dip. And our website is crazyfaithministries.org. For those who aren't on Facebook but want to see a playback of our service, you can go to our church online platform at crazyfaithministries.online.church. You can also visit our YouTube channel, which our services are posted on there as well, and it's in the description box. So thank you everyone for joining us again. Have a great week, and we hope that you continue to embody our motto and that we have come to worship and we leave to serve. Have a great week, everyone. Bye.